Wait, what? What do you mean they haven't checked in?
I mean that they haven't checked in.
What? So no one's heard from them?
Hello, everyone. This is Mark Sargent, and with me is my lovable and yet sometimes careless secretary. Say hello, secretary.
Hello.
And we are doing Flat Earth Q&A emails. I think this is 19. If it's not 19, it's 18, but I'm pretty sure it's 19. So let's start with the first one.
Okay. Your first email is from Jason. Mark, I'm sure you already know, but the video of the balloon launch for Stephen Hawking's B-Day is the best smoking gun I've seen. Also, it looks like Richie from Boston had converted to Flat Earth, which is great because he has a massive following. Please address the Hawking vid in a video if you get a chance. I'd love to hear your thoughts. Much love, brother.
Well, Jason, when the Stephen Hawking video came out, and I believe you're talking about the one where they were doing the helicopter across the water. I'm really hoping that's the one you're talking about, where they did a quick little laser test, I think, and were shooting across the water and then trying to see if the helicopter came out of view, showing the curvature of the Earth. I didn't do a video on that specifically, but you can check that out. There's other people that have done it. Just look up Stephen Hawking, Flat Earth, and I don't know if Jaron did a video on it or some other guys did a video on it, but they all tore it apart. It's obviously a piece of crap. And plus, you want to look into some weird stuff, look into the Stephen Hawking conspiracy, and if he's even coherent, if that's even the guy and who's typing his stuff. He's doing a lot of banter back and forth with his keyboard, and yet we're led to believe that he's doing that all with his eyeballs. I don't know. Anyway, Richie from Boston. Yeah, I caught his first Flat Earth thing, and it's really cool. Yeah, I love anyone that with new subscribers. So when you're out there talking to people, I don't care if you're hitting up a debunker or someone that's on the fence. Put it to them, and any the more subscribers, the better. Love the new guys that have addressed it. So thank you very much. On to the next one.
Okay, the next one is from John. Mark, I've been watching your videos on YouTube since around May of last year, and I've enjoyed it all very much. I've always been a huge conspiracy guy. Ufology is my number one thing, but I've become a huge flat earther over the past year, and I oddly enough believe that UFOs and flat earth can coexist. I have some theories and ideas that I was going to ask you about. I'd like to call, but I don't want to bother you at a bad time. Is there an appropriate time I could speak with you or maybe call into the show? Thanks for all your hard work for being so kind to everyone. By the way, I really enjoyed your debate with Stanton Friedman. Both of you were awesome.
Well, John, okay, here's the deal with that. First of all, ufology. I love it. I was a big UFO buff myself. And I do believe that UFOs and the flat earth can coexist. As a matter of fact, just about every other conspiracy coexists with flat earth quite nicely, with the exception of Richard Hoagland's stuff, where he is talking about millions of people living on the moon and millions of people living on Mars and all that other crap, which is why Richard Hoagland did not debate me. He backed out at the last minute. As far as talking to me directly, you know, I can get a little busy. So if you don't mind talking live on the air so we don't waste production value, and you don't have anything super personal to ask me, then call to the show, which is on Tuesday nights at 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern on truthfrequencyradio.com. And, you know, just be persistent. Don't leave a voicemail or anything, and I'll try to get to you. And last but not least, thank you for talking about the debate with Stanton Friedman. Stanton, it wasn't my favorite debate, obviously, because he went into this thinking that Flat Earth was just a figure of speech. If you guys want to have some fun, go back and listen to me debating Stanton Friedman on Truth Frequency Radio, where Stanton basically, you know, he was calling from the not just East Coast, but there's one more time zone east of Atlantic, and he was way ahead, and, you know, it was late for him, but he was kind of sleepwalking through it, and I you guys have probably heard me say this before. 10 minutes into the debate, Stanton's just stops me and he goes, whoa, 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 so flat earth's a real thing? Like, you're talking about this literally? This isn't a figure of speech? You're like, climate change and flat earth? And like, no. And then the debate kind of fell apart because he had to have everything explained to them. And which felt, I felt bad because he actually had an astronaut write a foreword to his latest book. So he's like, oh, are you calling this astronaut a liar? It's like, yeah, I am. It's not that I'm saying he's a horrible, terrible person, but he was lying. He may not even know the reason. Anyway, so thank you for that very much. Next.
All right, the next one is from Fred. Mark, this is Fred in Vero Beach. We have spoke before. I have a quick question. I totally believe the Bible and what you say, it does protect the truth. We do not move, nor does the earth move. But my question would be a Harrier jet going straight up in your backyard for any amount of time. You may tell it to do so to prove as once and for all. When it comes back down, it will not be in Iceland. As the world turns, and forgive me if this has been raised and is stupid, but I think it's a good question for me as it just came to me yesterday. Thanks, brother in Christ.
Well, Fred, here's the deal with that. And it's not a stupid question. Has it been asked before? Yes, many times. Not just with... I will say it's the first time it's ever been used with a Harrier jump jet, which is a jet plane that was used in True Lies by Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's a movie reference for you guys and a couple others. But a jet that can go vertical as well as horizontal. Other people have mentioned helicopters and, of course, the famous balloon and blimp ideas back in the day, which is, you know, if you launched a balloon up in the air, you know, wouldn't the Earth just rotate beneath you? Now, mainstream science is going to say that gravity is locking down that balloon or blimp or Harrier jet, and so that it's not going to just take off beneath you. If that was the case, I mean, think of the repercussions of that. Somebody with a decent vertical jump could jump straight up. And you know, the world would, you know, 1,000 miles an hour, might, you know, where I'm going with this. So, no, the better questions to ask if you're going to start going down that road is to look into airplanes that are traveling, because airplanes are just slow moving bullets, and they say that bullets actually have to deal with the rotation of the Earth in space. And yet, when an airplane lands on a runway, it doesn't have to counter for that runway that moving underneath it. So where you're going is good. So just keep going where you're going, and eventually you will, you know, it'll lead you down several other rabbit paths, and we'll just go from there. But thank you for writing in. Next.
Cool. Subject for the next one is Scrambled Brain. Hi. Thanks for getting back to me. This topic is taking over virtually my every waking thoughts. Being ex-military, I'm very interested and convinced by the accounts of Admiral Byrd, but I just can't get my head around the existence of a dome. And what background of the topic do you have? Is it just a belief or based on science?
Excellent question, because I am not a scientist. I do not have a degree in astronomy or astrophysics or geology or biology or hydrology or archaeology, anything with an ology next to it, I don't have a degree in. But when it comes to the dome, I was really doing the whole Sherlock Holmes detective work, where everything that I looked at kept pointing back to the same place, be it the Van Allen belts, be it the Antarctic Treaty, be it Admiral Byrd's missions, be it the flights in the Southern Hemisphere. It just goes on and on and on. If even a couple of those things would have pointed towards a different conclusion, I would have been skeptical. But every one of them kept pointing back to a Truman Show type enclosed structure, thousands of miles wide. And that's where, you know, it just, I was, treat this like a court case, in that the flat earth has somewhat of an advantage. Well, you'd think it'd be a disadvantage, because mainstream science should have volumes and volumes and mountains of evidence to back the globe. But flat earth, all they have to really do is create reasonable doubt in that globe. And it is surprisingly easy to do, because when you go and look at the evidence that is on the globe side, you don't find much. You find CGI pictures of Earth. You find almost a total absence of video footage from just about any angle in low Earth or past orbit. Astronauts conflicting testimonies, NASA engineers conflicting testimonies, it goes on and on. So that's how I, you know, yes, I did have to make a leap of faith. So when you say, is it just a belief? It is a belief on my side, but yet when I put, and so that's why when I put it out there, I said, somebody shoot down my belief. Somebody shoot down my leap of faith, because I'm going nuts and I'm losing sleep over this. That was almost 2 years ago when I made Flat Earth Clues. Flat Earth Clues is going to hit its 2 year anniversary here in April of 2017. And when I put that out there, I wanted somebody to shoot it down. Nobody's shot it down. Not only that, but I've had a bunch of professionals, subject matter experts, that have come out in support. None of them have recanted. Nobody has come out against them, and no scientist has even come forward officially and gone toe-to-toe with any of the Flat Earth community. So is it a strong belief? Oh yeah, you bet it is. And it's not something I wanted to do. This is something I've been thrown into by the universe at large. So prove me wrong. Next question.
All right. The next one says, my name is Jordan Thibodeau, and I just called you at 1:43 a.m. on January 11th, 2017. Your answering machine stated for me to email you, hence my email, sir. After viewing the film clip, They Are Hiding God with the Greatest Lie Ever, on YouTube, I found it most interesting indeed. I'm not a skeptic, however. Since we were taught about latitude and longitude lines as coordinates used in locating places, etc., these lines were designed or formatted based on a circular globed Earth. Am I not correct in saying that? Mark, I am not questioning the validity of the film clip, as I found it most interesting, and after viewing other Flat Earth clips, I do realize many people are indeed skeptical. And as previously mentioned, as it's quite a big pill to swallow, realizing the reality of what we've been taught was false and being deliberately falsified is rather disturbing to me. Of course, not that big of a deal, other than makes me wonder what else is there still falsely being taught, and when will this nonsense end? Point? So seems the moon landing is fake as well, right? Not to mention other of which are now in doubt. So please respond, would not the latitude and longitude lines we were taught be forgotten? Thanks for your time.
Well, a couple questions in there. First off, let me answer the last question first, which is moon landing. Yes, everything about the space program is fake. And that is, you know, treat it like a murder. I like to use the 90s movie Heat. And that is, once you fake the first thing, you might as well fake the rest of it. Because if you get caught in one, it's the rest of it, the credibility just goes out the window for everything else. So the Apollo landings, yes, you've got to throw those out right away. And I know it's tough if you're an American, because, you know, rah rah go team, wave the flag. Everything else, because some people say, well, the moon missions are a piece of crap, but definitely the ISS is real. Okay, fine, the ISS isn't real. Satellites are totally real. It's like, you're just hanging on by your fingernails at that point. Everything that you know about the space program is false. It is fake. And it's been, in fact, I have gone on record multiple times in saying that the entire reason NASA was created was because it was to hide the world that you live in. Science realized that they were wrong in the late 1950s. This is straight out of a Twilight Zone episode, really. They realized that they were wrong and they had to hide it. It was not that tough a decision to do, economically, religiously, scientifically. Everything would have been an upheaval. So they had to do this. As far as your latitude and longitude lines, yeah, the lines were designed for a globe, but everything, the globe model has been refined over the last 500 years. Everything's been put in place. But also remember that the maps, fine, they show you a globe in the classroom, but the latitude and longitude lines in a classroom are wrong, because they even the map that they pulled down, remember the map they pulled down behind, in front of the blackboard, that's a Mercator map. And you can go to any scientist right now and they'll tell you the Mercator map, which is also 500 years old, is dead wrong. There's nothing good about it. You want to look at at least a map that's correct in the size of the continents. That would be the Gall Peters map, which they've been trying to push in schools. They can't even get that in schools. The Gall Peters map, which shows Greenland, that is 17 times smaller than Africa. Even though if you look at the Mercator map, Greenland's this massive piece of ice, which nobody talks about. Kids have been staring at that for decades, if not 100 plus years, and saying, hey, why is Greenland so big and nobody lives there? Greenland's tiny by comparison. South America's huge. Nobody talks about this. It's a northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere thing, and we can't even get them to show that correctly. So, sorry, that's just me going off on a rant. Don't mean to bore my secretary with that one. Next email, please.
Okay, the next one is from John, and it goes like this. Greetings, Mark, from South Central Kelowna, British Columbia. I'm currently reviewing your documentary, Under the Dome, and I'm very happy to thank you for such an awesome effort to accurately inform the viewing public. Free thinking still has a chance to contribute a balanced perception of our place in this reality, or unreality, if it's correct to say it that way. I had initially thought to place a call to the number you provided, but I shall now simply leave it at thank you, all caps.
John. Was there a question in there? I don't think there was. Let me just comment on it. First of all, thank you for actually using balanced perception in your email, because it made me think of balanced breakfast, which is something that they put in just about every 70s sugar breakfast commercial. And as far, oh yeah, that's why I was going to answer this one. Don't forget that anyone that sees a YouTube video, there's two videos out there that get a lot of traction, which are me and yet aren't me. One is called Under the Dome, full documentary, and the other one is called They Are Hiding God with the Greatest Lie Ever. Both at this point in time have over 2 million hits each. Great. Thank you guys for doing that. The, you know, replicating my stuff and putting it out there. However, Under the Dome, full documentary, is not my main channel. My main channel is Mark K. Sargent, or you can just, when you go into YouTube or Google or any search engine, type in Flat Earth Clues, and that will take you to the main site. I also have a free site called enclosedworld.com and a subscription site called marksargent.com, and you are very welcome for all the influence that I'm having over your reality. So, thank you. Next one, please.
Okay, the next one is quite similar and short. It says, I have viewed two of the videos that you have on YouTube. I find them very informative and you don't talk over my head. Thank you, Mary.
Mary, and thank you for writing one such a precise email, because that's exactly what I was trying to do. When I made Flat Earth Clues, I decided to go to create it for just about anyone. And I am not trying to be insulting to anybody out there, but I was trying to portray and give a perspective on the flat earth concept to any age group. You know, you see game boards, it's like, oh, from ages 8 to 80. That's kind of what I was going for. So I used no math. I didn't even talk about the curvature of the earth. Everything was about as basic as you could get, and I use simple language. There's a couple rules I follow. One, I don't use any verbiage that is not used in mainstream news. So if you don't hear the word on CNN, I don't use it. I know there's people, English majors out there, it's like, no, you know, there's way more articulate ways of expressing yourself, and you can use phrases and terms that aren't you really use. It's like, yeah, but then you're alienating a huge part of the population. And so it's why I use simple words, if I can, simple concepts, and I try to boil it down. Also, remember that I used to do software training proprietary software back in the day. And some of these systems, a lot of them were payroll-based systems, were complex. And I was training blue-collar workers all over the country, at least in the United States and a few outside the United States. And I had to create different concepts for these people to it's like, okay, this is what this does. This is what this does. I don't care, you know, what the end, how the engineers built it. That's how I did. So I'm glad that it resonated with you, and hopefully, you know, you'll continue your journey down the flat earth path. Next, please.
Cool. Quick question from Brian. Mark, on one of your radio shows on YouTube, you mentioned that you would be in Canada on Saturday, January 21st. Can you tell me the city?
Yes, I will be in Souk, Canada. And if I can find the advertisement somewhere around here real quick, I will read it to you. I will be at the Souk Yoga Studio this Saturday. That's on 6750 West Coast Road in Souk. It is called Towards an Earthly Cosmology, Rethinking Our Terrestrial Home. And you can look it up at voicesofcascadia.wordpress.com. January 21st, noon to 4 p.m. There's a $30 cover charge, and I'll read the quick summary of it. In science, the final say is the discourse of all things earthly, What alternative ideas exist that challenge the current models of our universe in the scientific, mythological, and experimental realms? Finally, why is it important to revisit cosmology in an age of scientism, and what new and ancient discoveries are awaiting us by renewing our spirit of investigation? Join Green Man for an in-depth presentation, heated discussion, and holistic foods prepared by nature's chef, Tom Krall, and your host, Dante. Your world will never be the same, and I'm pretty sure they're having Flat Earth pizza as well. So it is not a Flat Earth mixer. I will be there. I'm just doing some speaking, but if you guys want to talk to me, in person right there, I'm not necessarily saying you should fly up to Victoria and go to Souk, because I'm sure there's going to be a Flat Earth mixer coming down the pipe in 2017. But thank you for that. So yes, Brian, that's exactly what I'm going to be doing. Next.
All right, the next one is from Ashley. Hey, Mark. So I've been subtly talking to my husband about different clues of the Earth not being a globe. I'll remind you from a previous email I sent you that this is, in his words, a divorceable topic in our house. But nonetheless, I've been persistent and I've just gone about it a different way. Anywho, I mentioned to him, didn't he find it interesting that if the moon controls the tides, why are there no tides in lakes? He immediately jumped to me, telling me that is absolutely not true. He said, growing up in Louisiana near Lake Pontchartrain, he and his brothers would go surfing on the lake. I obviously did not believe him, so I looked into it. I'll be damned if he wasn't right. And you know what pains me to say that, lol. So I just wanted to pass along my findings to you and get your thoughts on it. He told me the same is true for the Great Lakes, although I haven't been able to delve into it a whole lot. I was more excited to share the information with you, especially since I heard you speaking about it on your last Strange World show. Anywho, we will keep on keeping on looking for the truth. Have a great weekend, and I'm sure I'll be writing again soon.
Ashley. All right, Ashley. I do not know much about Lake Pontchartrain, other than I'm pretty sure it's a spring break destination. It's not too big a concern for me. I do know that the lakes, if there is any tidal effects on lake, they are extremely diminished. You say, well, that's because on the oceans, the oceans are so much bigger and they're all connected that the tides are connected too. And it's like, yeah, but then we get these weird things. Like in North Canada, there's these massive drops of tide. But yet when you're down in Florida, if you had the same massive drops, because Florida, almost the entire state is at sea level. I mean, literally at sea level, it would swamp the entire state. So why such the big swings in tidal forces? We don't know. It's not too big a concern to me anyway. It was something that was brought up to me by a listener a while back. It's interesting. But at the same time, one of my main points is you gotta let go of the moon as a giant force that affects the tides on this world. Because if it is an enclosed world, and I firmly believe that, not only is the moon as its own illuminated light source, but it is not projecting massive gravity waves, because that would be way tougher to do that from an object that's only like 30, 35 miles wide hovering above our world like a mobile around a child's crib. So I believe that the tidal forces are controlled down below like we do in any simulation, because it's easier to do that way. We use a form of molecular magnetism that affects water. It's way easier to do it down below. I will look into the Lake Pontchartrain thing. I don't think it's going to change my opinion on it. And it's really, for me, a minor point. Kind of like the test that were done on the toilet swirl. Guys want to look up some interesting things because the Coriolis effect. This doesn't necessarily have to deal with the moon. There's a huge YouTuber out there, one of the bigger ones, and has like 4 million followers, called Smarter Every Day. And he did a fantastic simul test from Northern Hemisphere and Southern Hemisphere, run the exact same day, the exact same time, the exact same equipment, to see if the drains would drain in different directions. And he even showed, he's not a flat earther, that the drains would not flow. It all depended on how you poured things down the drain. And that it was so light, so gradual, he was basically disproving the myth that they do run in different directions. It's really, really interesting. Check that out if you get a chance. It's called Toilet Swirl Experiment by Smarter Every Day. Next email, please.
Yet John B. Wells uses that as one of his main arguments for the Globe.
Good point. And I agree. It's one of those, and I wouldn't care even if it was real, because it's so minor in the grand scope of things. The globe model isn't just being created by us. You know, we're not the ones that are creating all the subtle things about the globe model. It's mostly being done by the people that built this place. So if they actually did have a molecular force, you know, some sort of gravitational force that was affecting the inner ring and the outer ring to simulate the globe, it's like, great. I was on board with that anyway. If it's not happening at all, fine with me. So what do you got?
All right, the next one goes like this. I love the videos. I listen every week after you post for a few months now. I am somewhat of a conspiracy theorist, and it didn't take much time to convince me that us sheeple have been lied to. I am born and live in New York. I agree with mostly everything you say. I would love to speak more about it with you. I haven't discussed with anyone besides my husband. He is somewhat on board, but not as passionate or cares about it as much as I do. I would like to get more involved currently. I am at work and don't have a lot of free time to post my own commentary. I am still in the beginning phase and researching. I am not a mathematician, so I take all of the flat earthers' math at face value and put faith in their calculations. I have some questions and opinions and hope to maybe listen to your show live and call in. One thing that I thought about is how they told us about the hole in the ozone layer. It intrigues me to think that this perhaps is a clue to something else. Keep up the good work.
Well, Christine, and thank you for all the comments and feedback. Wonderful to hear. And don't risk your current relationship. I try to encourage this. It's easy for me because I'm dating someone who's into Flat Earth. But anyone out there with a spouse or significant other that's not into Flat Earth, don't wreck your relationship just because of it, even though there's a couple of videos out there that are popping up where people are saying, well, you know what, you really should only, if you're a Flat Earther, you should only date Flat Earthers. I agree, but let's not go there right now. When it comes to the ozone layer, yeah, that was something was brought up, I believe, in the 80s. I'm not going to look that up right now. The Peanut Gallery would probably have something to say about it if we were doing this live. But the ozone layer, they announced there was a hole in it, and it was down in Antarctica, of all places. And I think that was done in the 80s. And it was saying it's real dangerous if you go there underneath this hole in the ozone layer. And I'm wondering if they were using this to kind of curb exploration in Antarctica. That was the first thing I heard, when I heard this news story, which was, holy smokes, yeah, you don't want to be in there. There's no ozone layer. That could be really super dangerous. So that's where I first heard of it. I don't know if it's a big clue because they haven't been talking about this in a long time. It was also that the ozone layer was a big push to get rid of fluorocarbon things like styrofoam containers for McDonald's and aerosols and hairspray products and anything that generate these weird little fluorocarbons. So did it have an effect? You know, was there an ulterior motive for that? I don't know, but thank you for bringing it up. It's interesting. I'll research it a little more, and if it comes up, maybe I'll have an update for you. Next, please.
All right, the next one is from Lloyd. This is from a conversation that I had with a cousin. Does the sun seem a little strange to you? Something is bothering me about the quality of the light.
Never mind that crash.
It seems off to me somehow. It's white. The light is white, just like the LED sunlight bulbs. I remember the sunlight having a more yellow quality. I've been changing out the bulbs in the house, and the old incandescent bulbs have a slight yellow cast. Some of the newer bulbs claim to be like sunlight bulbs. The new sunlight bulbs give off a white light. Could it be possible that we are being conditioned to associate white light with sunlight? Wasn't sunlight yellow? Am I reading more into this? Am I going overboard?
Well, you know, I like where your head's at, because you're questioning stuff. At the end of every one of my videos, I say, do your own research and ask questions. And you're asking a whole bunch of questions. Couple things I'd like to address here. Yes, sunlight has always been equated with yellow light. As a matter of fact, I'm kind of a big fan, because grow lights, even though they, Oh, wow. It really depends. Because I'm a big indoor lighting person because I'm from the Northwest. And so I was a big fan of simulated sunlight bulbs. And the bulbs, in that case, they were purple. LED lights, I am not a huge fan of. And it bugs me every time I'm driving on the road because I see every day I see more and more cars using LED kind of running lights. And the reason I say that is because I don't think LED bulbs will ever be able to simulate sunlight bulbs. Because technically, they're not even supposed to be shining people's eyes. They are low impact laser. That's not what LED stands for. The LED stands for light emitting diode. But they are low impact lasers. In fact, most of your health people, emergency services people, you do not shine LED lights into people's eyes. I've seen animals kind of shy away from having LED flashlights shown on them. I think they pick up on that stuff. So, but unfortunately, we are really big on convenience. Use the art of war line. People are like water. We almost always take the path of least resistance. I'm not saying that people are naturally lazy. I'm just saying that people take the path of least resistance. The reason why microwave popcorn is so popular. I'm gonna go off on a little rant here. Microwave popcorn is not a good thing. And yet, when you go into the store, 95% of the popcorn you see out there is microwave popcorn bags because it's easy. You throw it in the microwave, you hit one button, you walk away from it. You don't have to put oil in a pan and shake it around and make it. It's not, you don't have to add salt and do all these fun things. And I actually remember going in when I started doing my, because I'm old school, I'm older. So I remember, before microwave popcorn. And when I went into the store and I went shopping for the bags of kernels, I remember there was a bag, it actually had dust on it. Like a thick layer of dust on it, which meant nobody had been buying anything from but microwave popcorn. Also got to throw in the lawsuit for my, and I'm saying, okay, well, so what's wrong with microwave popcorn? I was like, well, what's wrong is we put convenience first, side effects second. There was a guy, I think 2 years ago, that won a lawsuit. One of his favorite things was he bought bags of microwave popcorn and he had this ritual where he would open up the bag right after came in the microwave and breathe in that buttery, fumy goodness. And it turns out it was carcinogenic and he got cancer from it. And he won a massive lawsuit. Not that that really counteracts the fact that he had cancer. I'd rather have no cancer than a briefcase of money and cancer. But the point is that LED bulbs. This is do okay to answer your first question first. Sunlight, do I think the sun is changing? I don't know about that. I think you might be reading into it a little much. So the sun, do I think it's unusual lately? You do some more research and see if there's other people posting things on it. Because if it's just you, then it's probably just you. When it comes to LED bulbs, though, guys, be careful when you're using those things. Do not shine them in people's eyes. And don't, car manufacturers are going to use them. The reason why the LED bulbs are being used is they use much less power. They never burn out. They're extremely durable. But the flip side is you're not supposed to shine. Our eyes are not supposed to see LED lights.
And you got to worry about those spiral bulbs with the mercury inside
Oh yeah, no.
The light bulbs are dangerous.
Incandescent bulbs, the old school bulbs that we've had for decade after decade after decade. There's nothing wrong with those bulbs. I'm going to keep using those things till they stop making them.
And you can get those in soft, which is this yellow shade, or clear.
This way.
Anyways, that's a lot of talk about
Sorry.
light
Yeah, I know. We
bulbs.
got a it is. All right.
Interesting response.
Sorry, I had to go off on a rant there. What you got?
Okay, Walter writes, I recently bought a couple of thermos coffee mugs, and I realized that the company has inadvertently proved something important. Since I have scaldingly hot mint tea in my mug, and the outside of the cup is not hot, the vacuum is preventing heat from traveling to the outside of the cup. This means that the sun couldn't possibly heat the Earth from 92 million miles away in a vacuum, right? Or am I missing something? Keep up the good work. Your videos have opened my eyes to many new things.
Interesting thought. And I've heard a couple of people talk about this because it does confuse the average person. So, mainstream science will say that the sunlight, the radiation from sunlight excites, I'm going to butcher this, excites the molecules in the atmosphere when it gets here and therefore generates heat. You're absolutely right. But at the same time, It's also going to it's also going to react to the objects that are on the ground, because there's some people say, well, if you're on the moon and there's no atmosphere, it still gets really hot in the sun and really cold in the shade. And it's like, yeah, if you believe in the whole moon thing. So I don't know really. You got a great point. There are some interesting scientific paradoxes which we can't really, no one can really test or address. If you're going to go down this road, I might as well go down the propulsion road, which is when we kick our feet and hands in the water, we're pushing off the water. When we're driving a car down the road, the car's rubber is actually pushing against the road. But if you're a rocket in a vacuum, what's your thrust pushing against exactly? If there's nothing to push against, then how can you get any momentum at all? It's like, well, you had momentum when you left the Earth. I'm going, yeah, it's fine when you left the Earth. But how can you make any course corrections once you get up there? I know I'm not exactly dodging the question you've got here, but you might be onto something with the sun trying to heat in a vacuum. If you're going to go down that path, we might as well go down the, if the solar system is traveling through the galaxy at 500,000 miles an hour, then if a ship is trying to go to Mars, wouldn't it just all of a sudden start losing velocity and the solar system just blow right by them eventually, and then the ship would be lost in space and the solar system would just fly away at 500,000 miles an hour?
I've also heard science say that explosions are not possible in space. Yet, isn't the sun just one big explosion? Isn't that what stars are?
Excellent point. Yes, the sun is supposedly a giant atomic bomb, a giant thermonuclear explosion. Notice I didn't say nuclear. Explosion in space. Yeah, you're absolutely right, which is long-lasting. An explosion that just keeps going and going and going for millions of years, supposedly. You're absolutely right. What we got next? We got a few more.
Yep. So, Marty says, hey, Mark, Marty again, listening to Q&A 18, and you were talking about the giant planetarium. And I got to wondering if the North Pole is as protected as the ice ring that surrounds us. And if so, wouldn't that make the very best spot for the projection system to be located? If it is, and the controlling powers know this, they would not allow anyone to go there, that they didn't want to go there. Your thoughts and knowledge on this?
Well, and by the way, thank you for mentioning that the last one was Q&A 18, which means this was actually Q&A 19. Now I know for sure. Yeah, when it comes to the projection system, here's the thing, because you're trying to equate the projection system with our old school projection systems, which is even in planetariums now, they are projected upon like a front screen television that we used to have instead of backlit, like what would, you know. We're making television so thin now that eventually we won't need official projection systems anymore. You can just put, you know, put the TV, the screens up high. They're so light, and just have them backlit. So you don't need, I agree with you that if you use the traditional projection system, the North Pole would be a great place to put it. And you could, you know, maybe disguise it with the Aurora Borealis and do some fun stuff where you're shooting the rays all over the place. But you're still going to run into potential detection from aircraft and some curious people doing some tests using different filters on their goggles. You know, you might be able to pick it up eventually. So I don't think that the projection system is going to, if there's even a front screen projection system at all, I think it's backlit. I think the projection system's up above, and I said this many times anyway, that it's up above either in the firmaments. Remember the biblical saying, the stars are actually, and Book of Enoch too, maybe, that the stars are actually in the firmament, or the projection systems on the other side. That would make it way easier from the builder's standpoint. Easier to maintain, not easy to detect, way some. But I like where your head's at. You know, you're just thinking a little more old school than you have to. Remember, technology, the stuff that we're coming up with is pretty antiquated compared to what this place was built with. Next.
Okay, this is the very last one.
Okay.
Hello, my name is Gwen, and I'm a real newbie to this flat earth. I have viewed several, if not hundreds, of videos regarding the subject. I guess what really got me was the moon and the clouds in front of and behind. No way can the moon be as far away as they say it is. What I can't wrap my head around is the volcanoes. Is this fake? How do they do it? I have looked for information on this subject and couldn't find anything. Can you direct me to the right place? I find this just so fantastic and exciting and just can't seem to stop looking for information. Also, when NASA says things about asteroids almost hitting Earth, that is just a lie, and they are just trying to scare us. So all our so-called space station and other satellites in space is a lie? I have so much to learn yet. I saw a video of someone shooting a rocket into the air and hit the dome. That was really interesting. I don't know if it was one of your videos or not. Do you have anything else that shows a rocket hitting the dome? I know when they did that, the Antarctica trip back in 1956, they lost a lot of planes flying into the dome, or was it the edge of the Earth? But there is no footage of that. Not that I know of anyways. Please help me to find more information.
Okay, Gwen, you got a few questions here, so I will try to rattle them off rapid fire, if I can. When it comes to volcanoes, if it's fake, I was one of the first people to actually mention, and I caught some flack for this in one of my clues, that says that the entire magma system, if everything is fake about this world, if the world has been created, and the jet stream up above that controls all the headwinds for the planes, if those are fake, and the underwater conveyor system that controls all the currents in the ocean, if they're fake, then the magma system also has to be fake. And some people really took offense to that. They were going, "Oh, whoa, man, you're going off the reservation here. You can't be saying that volcanoes are fake." I'm just going, dude, why not? I mean, if you can build a structure that's thousands of miles wide and thousands of miles high, what can't you do? So when it comes to the magma, I try to use the pet spider routine, or the pet lizard. Pet lizard's fine too. Which is, if you have a terrarium with a pet spider or a pet lizard, is any part of that terrarium going to be left to chance? So you put a light bulb in for it to have light, and put a little water, and you got racks and everything. But are you really going to leave anything in there completely unsupervised? I'll give you another perspective. If the volcano system was completely organic, and that's the word you're looking for here, is the magma system organic? You are risking a whole bunch, because remember, one super volcano, that's it, game over, and you've lost everything in the entire terrarium, because a super volcano generates a huge amount of ash, and once it clouds up everything, that's it. The sunlight doesn't get through, plants don't grow, and everybody runs out of food. All crops are dead in 2 months. So I do believe that the magma systems are fake. I might be one of the only people that talks about this. You might be able to find something on YouTube, though.
Well, what does it really mean to say that the volcanoes are fake or real? I mean, especially if you're assuming as a flat earther that the world was created, at least in your opinion, then, I mean, why wouldn't the volcanoes be part of that created system or world?
Yes.
And I don't think you could really call it fake at that point.
No, not fake, but at the same time, it's as controlled as everything else. If the jet stream is controlled, the underwater conveyor system is controlled, everything is controlled, the magma system is going to be controlled. So just don't, you can look into this a little bit more, but I may be one of the only people, I'm going to take credit for this, I may be one of the only people that's actually saying that the magma system is a controlled system and it's not organic. Because everyone says, well, it's volcanoes, there's lava going everywhere, it doesn't look controlled at all. It's like, well, it doesn't, but that's because it looks like a giant volcano. The second question was, blah, 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 blah. NASA's thing says things about asteroids almost hitting the Earth. That is just a lie. Yeah, absolutely. Are they just trying to scare us? Yeah, they are. Well, they're not trying to scare you. They're just trying to reinforce the globe. When NASA says, oh, there's a meteor shower coming. Whoa, look out. In every 6 months, they say, there's a comet shaped like a skull coming straight for us. And then, it never hits. That they're just reinforcing the globe. That's all they're doing. The better question is, with all those thousands and thousands of satellites up there and all these meteors coming through the system, why have we never heard about a meteor just getting battered by any sort of rock? It doesn't even have to be a big rock. A satellite gets just smashed into little pieces, and then NBC or Fox or one of the major television stations, HBO, they lose their programming because it's, they can't, they lose a region. We never ever see that. As a matter of fact, The more ridiculous aspect of it, and I can't believe they made a movie about it, was the movie Gravity with Sandra Bullock and one of my all-time favorite leading men, George Clooney, where there was a satellite that went out of control and debris would start flying all over the place and then eventually ran into their system, and that was what the whole movie was based on. That's exactly how it would go down. If one satellite goes, they're all going to go, because the law of averages says eventually, you know, because if it's a globe, it's just going to keep circling and circling and the patterns are going to get weird, and it's just going to be this cascade effect where it's just going to be a giant ribbon of jagged metal flying around, and then nobody's ever going to go up there again. We never hear about it. We never hear the threat about it. And every meteor shower that comes in, nobody ever says, look out, our satellite. You'd think there'd be retasking satellites all over the place. Get out of the way. No, they don't do any of that. Let's see here, blah, blah, blah. So I saw a video of somebody shooting a rocket into the air and hitting the dome. That was really interesting and don't know. It was not one of mine. That was an amateur rocket that was sent up. I think it went up like 70-something miles. And they claim, some people have interpreted it and said, well, it looks like it hit something. Well, when it hit, it obviously didn't destroy it. So if it is a barrier that it hit at 70-something miles, I'm not saying it's completely out of the question, but it's a soft barrier because the camera was still working when it hit. You'd think if it was a hard, harsh barrier, that thing, that rocket hitting at that sort of speed, that camera would have been vaporized. But it didn't. So, and I've talked about soft barriers in the past because we use that, I hate to say this, in the gaming world, soft barrier where you the physics get harder as you get closer to it. So as you're walking, there's this pushback. It's like an opposite effect of gravity that's pushing against you. I don't know though. Do you have anything else that shows a rocket hitting the dome? No, I don't. And that, I think that's one of the only rockets that I know, unless you look at some of the SpaceX stuff, but I don't put too much stock into it because I know there, I just say there is a dome. I just say there is a firmament. There is, it is an enclosed system. As far as things hitting it, I don't know. I think it's hundreds of miles up personally, but if something hit at 73 miles, I'm not going to completely discount it because I wake up every morning with a big bowl of flat earth. Let's see here. I know when they did the Antarctica trip back in 1956, they lost a lot of planes. You are mistaken there. What you're thinking of is the 1946 mission called Operation High Jump, when Admiral Byrd went down there with an entire carrier group to supposedly root out the last of the Nazis. Remember, the only people that were exploring Antarctica during World War II, the only country that was down there was Nazi Germany, which is super interesting because that totally feeds into the Indiana Jones thing, that the Germans were looking for all these magical artifacts, because as we know, magical artifacts would turn the tide, which is why they're not allowed here on Earth. Let me see, one last thing. You said, there is no footage that I don't know of any, please find information. So there's no, so 1946, and there is no footage. No, of course there's no footage of that. There's no recorded footage that I know of any conspiracy type nature that was done from Operation High Jump. Because I've heard the rumors, I will end this Q&A on this. I heard the rumors of what happened during Operation High Jump, that they did find the Germans down there, and that the Germans went to the advanced civilization that was down there, and they asked for asylum. And that advanced civilization said, okay, we'll grant you asylum, but if you do this, you can't come back. That's one of the protocols of this world. And that is, you can come in, you can hang out with us in the club, but you can never go back into your civilization. And as far as I know, with the exception of the weird cult movie Iron Sky and Iron Sky 2, which I don't think has even been released yet, the Germans have never come back, as far as I know. Anyway, that was it. So thank you guys very much for sending the emails, and we will try to do these next week. If you have an email and I can't read it on Strange World, which is on Tuesday nights on Truth Frequency Radio, I will try to do it. Sometimes I'll do it by myself, but I'd like to do it more with my loving but sometimes careless secretary. You up for another one if we do this one next week?
Sure.
She's just a jabberjaw, that one. So I will, if you want to email me at msargent23@comcast.net. That's msargent23@comcast.net. My email is, of course, on all my videos and on my websites and on YouTube. Anyway, with that, guys, stay flat and say goodbye.
Bye.